إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد إن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, الإمام البخاري compiled a hadith that is narrated by Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما أنه حينما قدم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إلى المدينة وجد اليهود يصومون ذلك اليوم Ashoura, the 10th of Al-Muharram. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam went to Medina, he found the Jews observing the fast on the 10th of Al-Muharram, which is the day of Ashoura. فَسَأَلَ He asked, what is this day? They said, هَذَا يَوْمٌ صَالِحٌ This is a righteous day. هَذَا يَوْمٌ نَجَّ اللَّهُ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ وفي رواية وأغرق فرعون وقومه This is a righteous day. This is a day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved the children of Israel and drowned the Pharaoh and his people. فصامه موسى Then سيدنا موسى عليه السلام fasted this day and out of that we celebrate that day By fasting it, we basically commemorating the salvation, the survival of the children of Israel against the Pharaoh, and at the same time we're following the footsteps of Musa alayhi salam. Here is the reaction of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, said, نحن أولى بموسى منهم. We have more of a claim, more of a right to Musa than them. Then he fasted this day, the day of Ashura, And then he commanded the companions to actually fast this day as well. In another hadith that is narrated by Qatada, رضي الله عنه, في صحيح الإمام مسلم, الرسول صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم, once he was asked concerning the reward of fasting this day, and he said, it is an expiation for the sins of the previous year, meaning the minor sins of the previous year. So there is a great reward in fasting the 10th of Al-Muharram, which is the day of Ashura. At the same time, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told that will the Jews fast the day as well. Then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam intended and he expressed that intention in wording. And the hadith is recorded by Imam al-Bukhari in hadith Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. He said, if I live to the next year, I will fast the 9th, just to be different from the Jews. If they fast the 10th with us, then we're going to fast the 9th, so we're going to fast the 9th of Al-Muharram and the 10th. Now, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died actually, and he did not execute that intention. That is where the scholars differ on should we or should we not. But the consensus, yes, we should fast the 9th and the 10th. And there is a wording also, there is a saying that is also out there that the 11th as well. But at least fasting the day or the 10th of Ashura is an expiation for the sins of the previous years. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this is the fiqh concept of this day. Now, When the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told about Musa alayhi salam and his people being saved from the Pharaoh and his gang, that was the main reason behind him initiating that sunnah. And he directed the companions and the ummah to also do the same, to actually commemorate or remember that day, the day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Bani Israel. What is the story behind that? We know when Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam was in Midian, and after he spent 10 years serving his father-in-law, he started journeying back with his family. A windy night, a rainy night, he saw a fire from a distance, and he approached the fire, seeking to get some heat. He was actually lost as well, and he thought that he may find guidance. And once he approached that fire, he found that fire in a tree, a green tree. They would call it a burning bush. And then he was called by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I am your Lord. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salam one on one, but from behind a veil. And the command was, اذهب إلى فرعون. Go you and your brother Harun to the Pharaoh. Show him the ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already given him some ayat. The staff, he commanded him there to experience that, to try that. And the staff turned into a snake. And he commanded him to place his hand, and it came out white. So he showed him some of the ayat. Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam made a request that, اجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي هارون أخي. Make for me a minister of my family, Harun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قد أتيت سؤلك يا موسى. Your request is done. You and Harun go to the Pharaoh. They went to the Pharaoh with the request of the Pharaoh to believe. Now, the Pharaoh is someone who really overdid it. He basically wanted the people to take him as an icon of worship, an object of worship. He told the people, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. Of course, he was ruling the superpower at the time, Egypt. And he told the people, I am your Lord. Worship me. أَلَيْسَ لِي مُلْكُ مِصْرَ وَهَذِهِ الْأَنْهَارُ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِي أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. Don't I own Egypt and all these rivers in Egypt? And he started brainwashing the Egyptians at the time. فَاسْتَخَفَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَطَعُوا. He played with their heads, and they obeyed him. And they actually started serving him. Now, at the time, Bani Israel existed since the time of Yusuf alayhi salam. We know from the story of Yusuf that Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, once he became a man of authority in Egypt, he told his brothers, اذهبوا بقميصي هذا فألقوه على وجه أبي يأتي بصيرا وأتوني بأهلكم أجمعين. Go with my shirt, cast it in the face of my father, he will get his vision back and bring all your family. All the family came and they lived in Egypt. Now generation after generation, years after years, they multiplied in numbers. They multiplied in numbers. They became a big population in Egypt. Now, the Pharaoh started persecuting them. They were the only people who presented Tawheed. They believed, La ilaha illallah. They refused to give in to the superpower at the time. They refused to follow the system. They said, no, we're going to stay believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in that guidance that we believe in, we were told by Ya'qub, Israel alayhi salam, that Allah will send for us someone who will deliver us out of that chaos. There is a way out. Now this person happened to be Musa alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands Musa to go back to the Pharaoh with one request. Number one, to show him the ayat, to believe, or hopefully allow the children of Israel to leave with him. If you choose not to believe, just let the children of Israel leave out of Egypt and go somewhere else that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed for them. Now the children of Israel at the time were the Muslims, were the believers. Now the Pharaoh is the disbelievers, is a person who claimed that he is a Lord and he wanted people to worship him. When Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam showed the Pharaoh his signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given him, the Pharaoh said, hey, that's easy. This is magic. We have magic. لَنَأْتِيَنَّكَ بِسِحْرٍ مِثْلِ. We'll bring you better magic. قَالَ مَوْعِدُكُمْ يَوْمُ الزِّينَةِ وَأَنْ يُحْشَرَ النَّاسُ ضُحَى. Listen, we have a day that all the Egyptians come out and celebrate. Let's compete on this day. You compete with my sorcerers. The Pharaoh collected all the sorcerers in Egypt. And it was face to face in front of everyone. Now, the sorcerers who were there seeking that reward from the Pharaoh, they actually asked him, أَإِنَّ لَنَا لَأَجْرًا إِن كُنَّا نَحْنُ الْغَالِبِينَ. Are you going to give us something if we help you today? He said, نَعَمْ وَإِنَّكُمْ إِذًا لَمِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ. For sure, and you will be brought close to me. They went and they told Musa, إِمَّا أَن تُلْقِيَ وَإِمَّا أَن نَكُونَ نَحْنُ الْمُلْقِينَ. Whether you throw first or we throw first. You throw your staff first or we throw our staff first. Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam told them, قَالَ بَلْ أَلْقُوا. You go ahead and throw first. فَإِذَا حِبَالُهُمْ وَعِصِيُّهُمْ يُخَيَّلُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ سِحْرِهِمْ أَنَّهَا تَسْعَى. Of course they work sorcery. You work in the eyes of the people. You don't really change nothing. Now the people started seeing their ropes and their sticks walking. فَأَوْجَسَ فِي نَفْسِهِ خِيفَةً مُوسَى. Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, it got to him too. قُلْنَا لَا تَخَفْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, fear not, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْأَعْلَى. You are superior. وَأَلْقِ مَا فِي يَمِينِكَ تَلْقَفْ مَا صَنَعُوا. إِنَّمَا صَنَعُوا كَيْدُ سَاحِرٍ وَلَا يُفْلِحُ السَّاحِرُ حَيْثُ أَتَى. Cast what is in your right hand, your staff, and it will eat all the ropes and sticks. Because what they done is sorcery. What do you have? Musa is not sorcery. It's true. Now, once the sorcerers saw this happening in front of their eyes, they knew that this is something for real. Because they know what sorcery is. They saw the staff of Musa alayhi salam turning into a real snake, eating their real ropes and sticks. فَأُلْقِيَ السَّحَرَةُ سُجَّدًا. Right away, they went down in prostration. قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ هَارُونَ وَمُوسَى. We believe in the Lord of Harun and Musa. Not in Musa and Harun, no. The Lord, رَبِّ هَارُونَ وَمُوسَى. Of course, that infuriated and got the Pharaoh angry. Now my helpers already turning in front of everybody. آمَنْتُمْ لَهُ قَبْلَ أَنْ آذَنَ لَكُمْ. Are you believing in him before I give you a permission? And he started threatening them. لَأُقَطِّعَنَّ أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ. I will cut your legs and arms from opposite sides and I will crucify you to the trunk of the palm trees. وَلَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ فِي جُذُوعِ النَّخْلِ وَلَتَعْلَمُنَّ أَيُّنَا أَشَدُّ عَذَابًا وَأَبْقَى. Look at faith, power of iman, faith, faith. قَالُوا لَنْ نُؤْثِرَكَ عَلَىٰ مَا جَاءَنَا مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالَّذِي فَطَرَنَا. This will not move us a second. فَقْضِ مَا أَنْتَ قَاضٍ. Do what you want. إِنَّمَا تَقْضِ هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. You only have power, authority in this world. They became breachers. They became defenders. That's what faith can do to you. If it penetrates your heart. In a day. In the morning they were enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the evening, they were callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah owns the heart. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide your hearts. Ask Allah to guide your heart. It's not difficult. It's not difficult. It is possible. Of course. فَمَا آمَنَ لِمُوسَى إِلَّا ذُرِّيَةٌ مِّن قَوْمِهِ عَلَىٰ خَوْفٍ مِّن فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَلَئِهِمْ أَن يَفْتِنَهُمْ. Only few out of, you see that huge sign out there, only few believed from the Pharaoh's side, his wife and the mu'min, Ala Fir'aun, the believer of Ala Fir'aun. And of course, the offspring of Bani Israel. And they were afraid of the Pharaoh. Now Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam delivers to them the message. وَقَالَ مُوسَى يَا قَوْمِ Of course the Pharaoh is punishing them. He started actually persecuting them more after what happened. Because his gang, the people who are sitting in his cabinet, قالوا أَتَذَرُ مُوسَى وَقَوْمَهُ لِيُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَيَذْرَكَ وَآلِهَكَ Are you going to leave Musa and his people do this, leave you and your gods? قَالَ سَنُقَتِّلُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ We'll kill their children and we'll double and triple the punishment upon them. We'll pass a lot of laws. A lot of laws that can give us power over them. We'll change the constitution. Don't worry about it. We'll do it. Now Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam وَقَالَ مُوسَى يَا قَوْمِ Here is the leader. My people. إِن كُنْتُمْ آمَنْتُمْ بِاللَّهِ فَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلُوا If you truly believed in Allah, then place your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَقَالُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا They said, we place our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they started using the weapon of the believer. الدُّعَاء رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْنَا فِتْنَةً لِلْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ Oh Allah, do not place us in a position of fitna for those who are oppressing us. وَنَجِّنَا بِرَحْمَتِكَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ And save us with your mercy from those who disbelieve in you. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to Musa alayhi salam the one tool that will help them to endure patience. وَأَوْحَيْنَا Because the Bani Israel at the time, they were so afraid to pray, to go to their temple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to Musa alayhi salam, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَى مُوسَى وَأَخِيهِ أَن تَبَوَّأَ لِقَوْمِكُمَا بِمِصْرَ بُيُوتًا وَاجْعَلُوا بُيُوتَكُمْ قِبْلَةً وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ We told Musa and his brother Harun to allow the children of Israel to let them know it's okay to pray at home. Because the salah is the reason, is the main source of patience. If you want to be patient, salah is going to help you. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ Oh, you believe? Find patience. اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ in the salah. That's another wording of this. In salah, the salah charges you to be patient. Now pray. Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam makes that supplication. رَبَّنَا وَقَالَ مُوسَى رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ آتَيْتَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَلَأَهُ زِينَةً وَأَمْوَالًا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا رَبَّنَا لِيُضِلُّوا عَن سَبِيلِ Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam make a dua against Fir'aun and his people, saying, you're giving them all this money, and you're giving them all this wealth, and what they are doing with it, they are hindering people from the path of Allah. They are killing the Muslims. They are fighting the Muslims. They are defaming Islam. They are trying to hinder people from following your path, Ya Rab. Now, O Allah, destroy their wealth and make them not to believe until they see the punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa and Harun, قَدْ أُجِيبَتْ دَعْوَتُكُمَا Your call is answered. I have answered your dua. But make sure that you stay in the straight path. فَاسْتَقِيمَا وَلَا تَتَّبِعَانِ سَبِيلَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ And then was the scene of the day of the 10th of Al-Muharram. Finally, the Pharaoh allows Bani Israel to leave. And they are approaching the seashore. And then the Pharaoh breaks his promise again. And he follows him with his army. And that was the scene. This is what happened on the 10th of Al-Muharram. فَلَمَّا تَرَاءَ الْجَمْعَانِ قَالَ أَصْحَابُ مُوسَى إِنَّا لَمُدْرَكُونَ When the two hosts came eye to eye, of course the companions of Musa, they said, we're going to be overtaken or taken over. There is no way. In front of us is the sea, and they are behind us with his troop, with his power, with his strength, and we have no weapons. Look at the believer. No. إِنَّ مَعِيَ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِي Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, no, I have my Lord with me. He will guide me. فَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَى مُوسَى And we revealed to Musa to cast the staff into the sea, and the sea split asunder, cleft asunder, and every side of it was like a mighty mountain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made for the children of Israel corridors, pathways, in the sea, so that they could pass. 12, for each tribe one path in the sea. And as soon as all of them passed, وَأَزْلَفْنَا ثَمَّ الْآخَرِينَ And we brought the Pharaoh and his people into the sea, and then they drowned, all of them. And here is the Pharaoh, says, آمنت فلما حتى إذا أدركه الغرق قال آمنت. Until he's about to drown, he said, I believe. Too late. الآن, now, وقد عصيت قبل وكنت من المفسدين. Now, you believing? And before, you used to be one of those wrongdoers? No, we're just going to save your body so the children of Israel believe that you will drown. This is the story, in brief. A story that is repeated all the time in the Quran. Almost in every chapter, at least one time in details. The most told story in the Quran, the story of Musa alayhi salam. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on this day is directing us, the Muslims, to observe fast and to remember this story again. Why? That is the question. Why? Because we may be going through the same exact condition of Bani Israel right now. We do. We are weak. We are somehow somewhat oppressed. We don't have really a lot happening for us. But the only thing that can still save us, brothers and sisters, and this is what the people of Bani Israel had, is to believe. To believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take us out of this condition if we help ourselves. Also, Muslims are starting to lay a lot of thinking on resources. We got to have this, we got to have this, we got to have that weapon, we got... Ya akhi, taqillah wallah. All what you have to be equipped with is iman. And what you can of resources. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defeated the fear with His mighty power. And Allah is able of doing the same exact thing for the believers. Because it's written, وَكَانَ حَقًّا عَلَيْنَا نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It is incumbent upon us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you that we will save the believers. إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ رُسُلَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. We will give victory to our messengers and those who believe in this world. Story that we need to look at. One ideal thing in this story, look at the leader, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. Sayyidina Musa was a project of a believing mother and a believing father. A mother who trusted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, during the time that he was born, the Pharaoh used to be killing all the children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to the mother of Musa, throw your son in the river. وأوحينا إلى أم موسى أن أرضعيه فإذا خفت عليه فألقيه في اليم ولا تخافي ولا تحزن. A believing mother, trusting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His promise. And she did throw her son into the river. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled the promise that He made to her. We may not have now the means to actually earn that victory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why don't you do like the mother of Musa alayhi salam and prepare your son, prepare your daughter? I'm not asking you to throw them in the river or in the sea. No, teach them their deen and rest assured that this deen will benefit them. Teach them iman. Be a good role model for them. Be a good example for them. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this story teaches us the value of patience during calamity. And that you do not change courses because you're down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa and Harun, فَاسْتَقِيمَا. Stick to the straight path. وَلَا تَتَّبِعَانِ سَبِيلَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Do not allow your condition that is not very good condition to deviate you from the straight path. Stick to the straight path because it's better for you. Because any other path is not going to help you. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this story teaches us dua. The importance of the dua. Calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This story teaches us the importance of the salah. When Bani Israel became afraid to pray outside, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed for them to pray at their homes. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam wanted us to learn from this day. This is it. This is what the day of Ashura is for. To look back upon the Muslims who came before us and learn from their story and benefit from that story, contemplate upon it, draw some lessons, maybe that will help you for a couple of days until you encounter the next story. Look what the Prophet ﷺ wants for us. A look at what some Muslims want for us. They turned the day of Ashura into another sci-fi, I would call it. And just watch the pictures in television. They chose one event that happened after the Prophet ﷺ, which is the murder and the killing of al-Husayn, rahmatullahi alayhi wa radiyallahu an, the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ, and they turned it into a mourning occasion. And this is not why this day was prescribed for. And since when, as Muslims, were we commanded to celebrate the death of the prophets, the imams, the companions, the followers of the companions? Well, if this is, I'm going to celebrate the death of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab was killed while he's reciting Quran in Fajr. Ridwanullahi alayhi. Sayyidina Uthman was killed while he's reciting the Quran in his home, unjustly. If I'm ready to celebrate the death of somebody, I mean, there is no other death that shake the ummah than the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now, you find a group of people, they take that event, and they end up expressing their mourning and their grievance over the death of al-Husayn. And we all feel sad for the death of al-Husayn. We all feel sad for the death of Umar ibn al-Khattab, radwanullahi alayhim jami'an. We all feel sad for the death of Uthman. We all feel extremely sad for the death of Ali ibn Abi Talib, who was killed while he was walking around, waking up the Muslims for Salat al-Fajr. We all feel sad. But is that how we were told to express our grievance and sad? To walk out in the street in groups and carry chains of iron and beat yourself up and cut your head? And look like a jahil. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells you in the hadith that is recorded by Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma fi kitab al-janayis, sahih al-imam al-Bukhari, laysa minna, laysa minna, he is not of us, man laqam al-khudud, the one who slaps the cheeks, wa shaqqa al-juyub, and tear the clothes for mourning, wa da'a bida'wa al-jahiliyya, and he uses words of jahiliyya to express their grievance and mourning. The term laysa minna, the fuqaha, means that this is a major sin. And if this is something to be done, to express your mourning and your grievance, I think Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have been worthy of expressing that. When his son Ibrahim alayhi salam died, we know in Sahih al-Imam al-Bukhari, min hadith Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhuma, that all he did is he shed some tears. And he said, إِنَّ الْقَلْبَ لَيَحْزَنْ, the heart grieves, وَالْعَيْنْ لَتَدْمَعْ, and the eye tears. We don't say anything that makes Allah angry. Nothing. Innovation. Total innovation. And it has to be denied. And it has to be talked about it. It has to be denied. Because that's how you're seen as a Muslim now. The Sunnah tells you that we're celebrating and commemorating the 10th of al-Muharram for this cause. Now other people came up bid'ah. That tells you that the impact of bid'ah on this ummah. Bid'ah is innovation. That somebody comes with his own little thing going, right there, divides the ummah. Those are the people who actually align. They claim the love of the people of the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ahl al-Bayt. And they end up cursing companions, calling them names. Wallahi, I would be ashamed to utter just one word. And it's their scholars. Their scholars. They would call the companions, Abu Bakr and Umar, names, the son of this. Is that a justification? Ya akhi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ. Allah is pleased with the believers giving you the pledge under the tree. And now you're coming and telling me Umar and Abu Bakr is kafir? Allah tells me that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells you that I seen a palace for Umar in paradise. And you're coming me, Umar is kafir? Abu Bakr is kafir? Ya rajil ittaqi Allah fi nafsik wa fi ahlik. لا يصح هذا لقد تاب الله على النبي. That's a Quran. You're contradicting the Quran. Allah has accepted the repentance of the Prophet والمهاجرين and the immigrants والأنصار and those who supported them الذين اتبعوه في ساعة العسر. And this verse was revealed at the end of the battle of Tabuk, a couple of years before the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. What are you going to do with this text? That's not the way to go about it. That divides us. We love Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. We love al-Husayn radiyallahu anhu. We love al-Hasan. But we love them the way that pleases Allah and pleases our messenger and pleases them. But we don't place them in a position that is not theirs. And at the same time, we don't have any right, any ground to curse any of the companions. So they made this day a sign of that. The rest of the world understand now the day of Ashura. If you ask an average person, and I'm telling you a lot of Muslims are not aware that the day of Ashura was prescribed for this event that I narrated at the beginning of my khutbah. They will tell you, oh, this is the day when some Muslims say and do this stuff. Here Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells you, this is the day that Allah saved Musa and his people. Now, fasted because we have more of a right to Musa. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants us to have more acclaim to our messengers. And now these individuals are trying to divide the ummah by aligning to certain companions and cursing the other companions. And you see, on the other side, like those people, they came with that. They appointed the day of Ashura as a day of mourning, and they claim that they are the protectors of the house of the Prophet and all these series. We know it. We hear it all the time. Now on the other hand, you find out another group of Muslims, I don't like calling anybody names, but another group of Muslims, in order to defeat their claim, they say, okay, in the day of Ashura, we're going to do this. Whoever provides a good meal for his family, Allah will provide for him in abundance until the end of the year. And he says, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال رسول الله فين يا قال أبو لمعة not رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Who said that? He tells you, whoever takes a path on the day of Ashura, he will never be sick until the end of the year. يا سلام. يا راجل. In order to turn it what? As a day of joy. And this group is wrong, and this group is wrong. A Muslim with a proper creed respects, honors, values all the companions. We do not claim that they are perfect. Nope. They are subject to making mistakes. But yet, their mistakes does not entitle us to go after them and call them names, curse them. When Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, La tasubbu ashabi. La tasubbu ashabi. Don't curse my companions. فَلَوْ أَنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ أَنْفَقَ مِلْأَ أُحُدٍ ذَهَبَ. Don't curse my companions, because if any of you spends the size of the mountain of Uhud in gold, he will not. مَا بَلَغَ مُدَّ أَحَدِهِمْ وَلَا نَصِيفًا. He will not reach 2/3 of a kilogram of one of them. So this is the sad part about the 10th of Ashura. And the problem is, a lot of Muslims are not aware of that. They are asleep. They don't even take their time and study this and find out what is happening here around them. They are not even interested in learning their deen, their creed. Brothers and sisters in Islam, a lot of traps out there are set for you to make you lose the hereafter. It's extremely easy for you to fall into one of these traps. And the only thing that will save you is learning about your deen. Learning about your deen. Iqra, iqra, iqra. Read, read, read. so that you may learn what is happening around you, because it's extremely important for all of us. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبد الله ورسوله. Teach your children to love the companions, to respect them, to honor them. And how can you love someone that you don't know a whole lot about them? You cannot imagine if you open the books that has authenticated accounts, how much these companions did for the sake of Allah, for Islam to be here. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right before the battle of Tabuk, stands. Was a very difficult year, extremely difficult year for the Muslims. Year of drought, no rain, and there is some fruit is about to be there, some harvest. And he's now asking the companions to give in order to prepare the army, because they are threatened by the Romans. Whoever prepares the army, and he will have al-Jannah. Uthman ibn Affan stands and says, I am Messenger of Allah, I'll do it. Again, I am Messenger of Allah, I'll do it. Again, I am Messenger of Allah, I'll do it. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells him, go Uthman, do as you please. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you Jannah. When the Muslims arrived in Medina, the only source of water, a well called the well of Rumiyah or Roma, was owned by the Jews. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, من يشتري هذه وله الجنة. Whoever buys that well, he will have paradise. Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan goes, and you're cursing Uthman ibn Affan, يا أخي اتق الله. He married two of the daughters of the Prophet, Dun Nurayn, Umar ibn al-Khattab. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells you, إن يكن لقد كان في الأمم من قبلكم. And in one of the wordings, سمى بني إسرائيل محدثون. People who think about things in their hearts, it happens. فَإِنْ يَكُنْ فِي هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ فَعُمَرْ. And if it is, someone in this ummah is Umar. He tells you, I saw you Umar walking in Jannah with a thawb that is dragging in the ground. He was asked, وَبِمَا أَوَّلْتَهُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. How did you interpret this messenger of Allah? He said, الدين, his religion. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, ثاني اثنين, إذ هما في الغار. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. One of the two who were in the cave with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, wait a little bit, do not migrate right now. When the father of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu became a Muslim, Quhafa, he was an old man, so he could not move. So he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if he could, Later on, in Medina, can you come and take his shahada in his house because he cannot move? He said, certainly. And as the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam takes his shahada, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq cries, Ma yubkika ya Abu Bakr? Why are you crying? Abu Bakr, he said, Ya Rasul Allah, Wallahi, I only wish that this is your uncle, not my father, because I know you loved him so much and you wanted him to believe. Is that somebody to be cursed? كَبُرَتْ كَلِمَةً تَخْرُجُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ إِنْ يَقُولُونَ إِلَّا كَذِبًا. If you hear any of this, you are to deny, at least with your heart, at least with your tongue. But you could counter this by learning about the companions, by defending them. Because you know what? There is no way of salvation for you, and I close with this, but by learning about these companions. When the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam predicted the split of this ummah, that the Jews divided into 71, the Christian divided into 72, and you will divide into 73 sects. He said that. كُلُّهُمْ فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدًا. All of them are in the hellfire but one. What is this one, Messenger of Allah? مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ الْيَوْمِ وَأَصْحَابِي. The way that I am today and my companions. So now, how are you going to take the deen from people that you curse, from people that you do not honor, you do not respect? It's time to wake up, brothers and sisters. Maybe your parents have brought you up with a certain level of immunity against this. But you know what concerns me? That we're taking all these things for granted, and our children can be an open target that they will penetrate to them. Maybe your parents back home did a good job, made you understand. But it is now your turn to do the same to your children. And the only way you're going to do this is through knowledge, by learning. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اللهم ارحمنا برحمتك فأنت أرحم الراحمين اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا واعف عنا اللهم اجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر اللهم إن أردت فتنة بعبادك فاقبضنا إليك غير مفتونين يا رب العالمين اللهم أمتنا على الإسلام وأحينا بالإسلام قولوا قولي هذا.